I'm going to focus on several different things, but I'm mainly going to talk about workers and generally, and then I'm going to try to focus more on the lower income part of the labor market with a specific emphasis on African Americans. So let me start. Can you guys hear me okay? We're good? Okay, good. I have a PowerPoint up here. I hope you can see it. I tried to make it big, but you never know. There's a lot of debate about immigration and its impact on jobs. So let me start with some things, hey, where there's really no debate. Okay, so pretty much everybody agrees that the employment rate, not unemployment rate, employment rate is the share of people in any age group who actually have a job. It's a really simple statistic. It's whatever fraction of, you know, 16-year-olds or 65-year-olds or 16 to 65-year-olds with a job. And it's slightly different than the labor force participation rate. We're going to talk about both of those. Labor force is just how many people or what share of people, again, in some age group, either have a job or at least looking for a job. Looking for a job means you're officially unemployed. To be unemployed, you have to look for a job in the last 4 weeks. So that's why sometimes people focus on things like the employment rate. If you look 5 weeks ago, you're not officially considered unemployed in the government survey. If you'd like to work but haven't looked, you're not. If you're so discouraged, you wouldn't be unemployed. So that's why we look at things like the employment rate, just the share of people with a job, very straightforward, and sometimes labor force participation. I'll remind you again what they are, but it's just the share of people with a job or at least looking for a job, again, at some age group. You usually exclude the oldest folks because most of them don't work. Anyway, the situation for all workers of all educations, of all races, of all genders, is basically that we see that their employment rate, share with a job, or labor force participation, share with a job or looking for one, are at near all-time lows. The number not working is at all-time highs and things like that. The wages have generally stagnated, or for some groups, the most educated, people with PhDs, people with advanced degrees, they have seen some wage growth. But basically everybody else, no. And especially for those without a bachelor's degree, who, I should point out, make up, you know, two-thirds of all working Americans don't have a bachelor's degree. I know it sometimes seems like everybody has a bachelor's degree, but that's because we all tend to extrapolate from our own experience. When I got my PhD, my wife said to me, "Steve, I'm so proud of you. You have a PhD." And I said, "Eh, but everybody I know has a PhD. What's the big deal?" But it's true. We all tend to extrapolate. The fact is, two-thirds of Americans don't have any don't have a bachelor's degree. And remember, about 40% of Americans, this is native-born Americans, have no education beyond high school. They either dropped out of high school or stopped at high school. They didn't get any other additional schooling. So when we look at the less educated, as I just mentioned down here, can you see that little? See, I should have brought one of the lasers from one of my guns. It's so much clearer. But then again, see, we're in Virginia. I'd be allowed to do that. This little thing you can barely see. But anyway, so for the people at the bottom end of the labor market, it's not just stagnation. As I'll show you, it's an outright decline. The share holding a job, the share in the labor force, and so forth. It looks terrible for people at the bottom. It's a crisis, if you will. Okay, so let me show you what's happened in the labor market. Again, no one's disputing this, but always keep this in the back of your mind. Congress, the Senate, passed a bill last year to double the number of foreign workers allowed into the United States. Very roughly, we could talk about numbers from 1 to 2 million a year, but they doubled it. And this is what's been happening in the U.S. labor market. Here we're looking at only people 16 to 65. And the way you read this is, the number of people 16 to 65 in the United States, even though we are an aging population, nonetheless, the number of people of working age has grown a lot. So basically, it grew from 80 million to 206 million in the last 14 years. But how many of those people were actually working? Well, the number actually working went up less than 6 million. So basically, you have a 26 million or nearly 26 million growth in the number of potential workers, but less than a 6 million growth in the number of actual workers. And that's why it shows here the number not working was about 48 million back in 2000. Now it's almost 69 million. So you have an explosion of non-work. No one disputes these numbers. Everyone says, yeah, well, it's true. The working age just don't work very much anymore. And I'll show you how that plays out in another way. Here we're going to look at labor force participation. And, oh, I'm sorry. No, let me show you something else about what happened first. Here we see who got those jobs. I mean, there was some job growth, so who got the jobs? Well, let me show you about the working age population right here, the change in the size of the working age. The working age population of natives went up almost 17 million, and the working age population of immigrants went up almost 9 million, which means that about two-thirds of the growth in the number of working age people was among the native-born, not immigrants. Anyway, if you look over here, you'll see that the number of immigrants working went up about 5.7%, or 5.7 million. The number of natives holding a job over the last 14 years actually declined. It is not too much to say that when we look at the working age, all of the net growth in employment went to the foreign-born. Again, remember that the Senate wants to double the flow of foreign workers into the United States. But this is truly amazing. It's going to get better in the next year or two before the next recession. But still, it'll still be the case that the natives account for most of the growth in the population of working-age people, and immigrants will get most of the jobs. Or so far, it's been all of the jobs. So let me show you something else. Now, sometimes people say, well, it's really this bad recession, sometimes referred to the Great Recession. If it wasn't that, things wouldn't look so bad. So this just shows what's happened to 16 to 65-year-olds for the last 14 years. This dark line right here is the native-born. And the other line, this dotted blue line, is the foreign-born. So basically, the foreign-born, about 73% were working in 2000. 73% were working in 2014, okay? But what you see here is that for the native-born, you have basically a near uninterrupted decline in the share in the labor force. So it used to be that 77% of native 60 to 65 had a job or at least looked for one. Now, you're down to about 72%. There has been no improvement. Remember, the jobs recovery begins here, and you can see some improvement for the immigrants. And they just didn't go down as much, and they've just recovered. The natives still haven't recovered. Maybe in the next year or two they will, but it's going to take forever to get back to this percentage back here, and there's no indication it's ever going to get back to what it was in 2000. Now, we could look at it a lot of different ways, but let me just show you one way to think about it. If we look at just the basic employment rate, so this is just the share with a job. 2000 to 2014. Again, what you notice is it isn't just the recession. Things decline for every educational group. Here we're looking at people a little bit older, 18 to 65, because you don't want to include the people in high school when you're looking at education statistics. So this is people with a bachelor's, this is some college, this is high school only, and this is less than high school. So what you see is from 2000 to 2007, which should be two peaks of the expansions, the share of native-born people holding a job was way down. And it, of course, after the recession, it went way down. And it's not, in some cases, it hasn't recovered at all. We, again, have an explosion of non-work, and it's heavily concentrated among people who don't have a bachelor's degree. And that's what you see here. The bachelor's degree people, yes, they've had a problem, but it's nowhere near as bad. Actually, it's the graduate level people who tend to have done the best, both in wages and employment. It's the people with just a bachelor's degree have done much more so-so. But I'm going to talk more about the less educated. Now, let me show you what's happened to their wages. This is some stuff that the Economic Policy Institute did. And I've compressed time here, but this is 1979, this is 2000, and this is 2012, the last data they had. So this is hourly wages. So if you're not working, you completely drop out. And it's controlling for how much you work. So the situation's actually quite a lot worse than this because people tend to be working fewer hours in many cases at the bottom end of the labor market. If you know anything about how Target and Walmart and all those stores function, they never give you a full-time schedule. They try to keep you under a certain number of hours. But forgetting that, just looking at what they earn hourly, and all of this is adjusted for inflation in 2012 dollars. So basically, people with some college, high school or less, and people who didn't graduate high school, they all have experienced a real decline in wages, a long-term decline as well. It is not just this recession. They generally all make less than they used to, even when you control for hours worked. If you don't, it looks worse if you look at annual stuff. So what we have is, remember, a Congress that wanted to double the level of immigration on the argument that we don't have enough workers. We've got a shortage. There's no one to mow the lawns. There's no one to work retail. There's no one to work hotels. There's no one to work construction. We hear that constantly on Capitol Hill. Yet when we look at the share of people who have a job, who have that level of education that normally do that kind of work, it looks terrible. We look at real wages, it looks terrible. What should wages do if we have a shortage? They should be going up and up and up as employers try desperately to hang on to the few workers that they have and to recruit new ones. That's not what's been happening. There is zero, zippo, nada, no evidence of any kind of a labor shortage in America, particularly at the bottom end of the labor market. And yet, that's all we hear from Congress, that's all we hear from the business associations, and again, the Senate voted to act on that and double the level of immigration, a large fraction of which would be without a college education. Now, the decline in employment rates have been more pronounced for less educated African Americans. The statistics start out looking worse and they decline somewhat more. I've put down here the 2014 rates for each group. So for those with some college, only 62% of blacks now work. These, again, people of working age, 18 to 65. In this case, it's 21 to 65 because it's people with some college. But the point here is that only 62% work. If you want to see the rate for white, it's 70%. But all of the whites have declined a lot, too. The African Americans are not alone. It's just now for African Americans with only a high school education, 18 to 65, only 56% actually have a job. And this is the first quarter of this year, so it's not very long ago. It's much higher for whites at 67%, though that, again, represents a big decline. And then finally, if you're a black person in America, working age, without a high school education, only 1 in 3 have a job. Now, I should point out something else. You might think, well, the high incarceration rate of African Americans, particularly African American men, might play a role in these statistics. No, it's not included here. This is the non-institutionalized population. The stats look much worse if we put all the people in institutions in here. I've taken them all out, just so you don't have to think about those. I'll show you something else. If I can get this to change for me. Okay. If you look at young folks, the situation looks even worse for African Americans. These are folks of all education, so there's a lot of college grads in here, but at least in the top one. These are people 20 to 29. So basically 66% used to work. There was some decline through 2007, and now only 58% of black Americans, these are native-born black people, 20 to 29 actually have a job. Right, the corresponding figure for whites is 72%. Okay, so if we look at those 16 to 24, another way of thinking about the black youth population, only 36% now work. And again, these are native-born statistics. And then finally, for black teenagers, only 15% now work. Now, it's low, and it has declined for everyone, including whites. But remember, twice the share of white teens still work, 29%. And here, at 36 for that 16 to 24 group, it's 50% for whites. So look, you know, it's not that great for whites, let's be clear. But it's much worse for African Americans. They started worse, and their decline in some cases was steeper. So now, what's so, and I remember, there's nobody in prison in any of these populations. No one's in reform school. It's the non-institutionalized population. Now, what's really bad about these numbers, just to make them even worse, is there's a large body of research that shows that if you don't work when you're young, that problem tends to follow you through your life. In other words, if you're 17, you kind of, or 18, especially if you're not going on to college, you kind of have to learn the skills necessary to function in the labor market, like not telling your boss he's an idiot even when he really is. We all have to learn that. And you have to show up on time and treat customers with courtesy. And it turns out it's a lot easier to learn that at 16 or 19 than it is at 26 or 29. And if you don't learn it, you tend to have an attitude. You tend to have problems through the rest of your life, and it tends to have an impact on what kind of jobs you do, whether you're going to work, how much you make, and so forth. So this is actually an unremitting social disaster, some of which we're never going to be able to undo because the people will get past the key age group. But again, what we keep hearing is there's a labor shortage. And there's a labor shortage. Despite that 70 million people not working of working age, despite these percentages that look absolutely terrible, despite declines in wages. Okay, so let's, now, does immigration affect African-American employment? I must tell you, the research is mixed. Some people say no. I've put up here just a couple studies that do find it. Borjas and his colleagues found that a 10% immigration increase reduces wages by about 3% for blacks, but reduced their employment rate by about 6 percentage points. So that's a very big effect, especially when we can see these kinds of declines. The other interesting finding, now it wasn't a huge effect, but it was statistically significant, is it also increased their incarceration rates. And the idea was that as immigrants crowded African Americans out of jobs, it tended to make more people more willing or more likely in some cases to commit crimes or at least end up incarcerated. Now that seems pretty controversial, but this study here that came out at the same time in another regular academic journal called Social Forces essentially found the same thing, that immigrant-induced job competition increased black unemployment, and they were measuring unemployment, not labor force participation or employment rates, but still, and that caused an increase in black crime in areas of heavy immigrant settlement. And there's some older work I cite here. When the RAND Corporation looked at California about a decade and a half ago, they also found that the group that tended to do the worst as a result of immigrant competition was black. So some, and there are other research showing these kinds of outcomes, but again, the research is mixed. No one disputes everything else I've told you. It's just causally, it's always hard to know what wages or employment would be in the absence of something that actually happened. In a nutshell, is we only have the America that got the immigrants. We don't know what wages or benefits or working conditions or employment rates would be. And it's very hard to know for sure. Now, the way you try to do that is you look at different populations, maybe across cities or across age groups or across educational categories. But again, it's not the same as knowing what would have happened in the absence. When you do those kinds of comparisons, sometimes they don't show a harmful effect on blacks, but a lot of times they do. And it's kind of across the board, wages, employment, and then perhaps even incarceration. So all very negative outcomes. Okay, so why would African Americans maybe more likely to be affected by immigrant competition? Well, partly because of their education levels. About one third of whites, U.S.-born whites, have a college degree, but it's only one-fifth for blacks. So they're much more likely to be in jobs that pay less, that work at the bottom end of the labor market. As I point out here, they're more likely than whites to be in cleaning, maintenance, groundskeeping, food service, construction, hospitality in general than are whites, and it partly just reflects their educational attainment. So that is another reason why. Now, there might be other reasons why immigrants might be able to outcompete natives generally. This wouldn't just apply to African Americans, except one case it might be special for them. But there are several reasons why they might compete. There's a concept in economics called a reservation wage. This is the idea of, look, it doesn't make any sense for me to work below $8 an hour. I have to drive to work, that costs money, and if I'm only going to work 4 hours, that kind of thing, it doesn't really make any sense once you take into account transportation and inconvenience and the fact that taxes come out of it. So a reservation wage is the wage at which you will not work for any less. And it's probably true that immigrants have a lower reservation wage. They're willing to work for less. And there are other reasons as well. One reason might be that, and I'll run through these quickly, positive stereotypes of immigrants, negative stereotypes of blacks. Immigrants have hiring networks that might shut out blacks. Once the foreman of the warehouse becomes an immigrant, he tends to tell all his other friends and family and people who live in his apartment building, and those people are not black, and so blacks might tend to get shut out, and this would be true generally of natives. And other factors, immigrant entrepreneurs who often are in big cities may have a strong preference for hiring their own. There might be the truth that immigrants are more mobile. Because coming to America makes you so much better off, particularly for the less educated, that an $8 an hour, $9 an hour job in Texas looks pretty good. But if you're in upstate New York or western Pennsylvania and you're a native born black or not, it doesn't really matter, moving to Texas for a $9 an hour job may make little sense. But if that's tripling your wage or doubling your wage, well, it looks good to an immigrant. So immigrants may be more mobile. If we didn't have the immigration, the employer in Texas would have to offer higher wages to attract native-born. But now he doesn't. He just can offer the lower wage, and it looks good to the immigrant. So that probably plays some role as well. Finally, very briefly, there are policies that make immigrants more attractive. Just to give you an example, the summer work travel program, employers don't have to pay Social Security and unemployment insurance for those workers. If you hired an American worker, you would have to. H-1B and H-2A workers and H-2B workers, they can't change employers as easily. So they get captive. Again, that might make them very attractive to employers as well, more attractive native. So all of these factors almost certainly play a role in displacing folks from the job market. Okay, final, let me go, conclusion. There's absolutely no evidence of a labor shortage of any kind. If you did an analysis by occupation, you could even look at high-skilled, which we didn't do here, there's not been much growth in the so-called STEM jobs, science, technology, engineering, and math. And nobody thinks there's been any wage growth in construction. Nobody thinks it for groundskeeping. Nobody thinks it for hotel maids or nannies or busboys. Nobody finds lots of wage growth. There's simply... no evidence of a labor shortage. Blacks might be particularly worse off because they're more likely to compete with the immigrants. And finally, research is mixed, but there is good evidence that immigration reduces labor market opportunities for natives, blacks in particular. So there you go. That's it. I finished on time. Well, I think I went on like a minute.